Health that she wishes to make a statement on health and wellbeing 2026, delivering together. Just before calling the Minister to make her statement, I would remind the Minister that Standing Order 18A2 requires her to make a written copy available to members at least half an hour before delivering it in the Chamber. The Minister did not meet that requirement this morning. Therefore, in accordance with Standing Order 18A2, I would ask the Minister to state the reason for this prior to making her statement. Minister.
And can I start by apologising for the lateness of the statement? Obviously, we had an executive meeting this morning and I endeavoured to get the statement into pigeonholes, and I believe we did so at 10 o'clock. Can I, Mr Speaker, having received executive endorsement this morning, I am grateful for the opportunity to make a statement setting out my ambition for a world-class health and social care system. Health and Wellbeing 2026, delivering together. As I've said before, and I want to put on record again, I am proud and I think I'm privileged to be the Minister for Health. I am proud of our health and social care service. I am proud of the dedication and the commitment and all the hard work of all those working right across the health and social care system. I am proud of the quality of the full range of health and social care services people here receive from staff whose key focus is to improve our health and wellbeing. I have witnessed at first hand the amazing work of the HSE and the positive impact it has on people's lives. The depth of the dedication, commitment and compassion of all those who work and work right across our health and social care system continues to astound me. However, the system itself is at breaking point, and this is not news. Every person in the North and everyone working in our health and social care system understands this to be the case. Put simply, the system has not changed quickly enough to meet the demands and the needs of the population. While not always accurate, reports of long waiting lists and failed targets feature regularly on the media. This is why, in my first week as Minister, I made a statement to this House acknowledging the challenges, but more importantly, pledging my commitment to transform health and social care. I promised I would reflect on the expert panel's report and put my vision for health and social care before you, and today I am doing so. Ken Corley, I want to thank Professor Bengoa and the expert panel and commend them for their work. I received the report, Systems Not Structures, in the summer, and since then have spent time carefully considering the report, its implications and the next steps. Professor Bengoa has told us that we need whole system transformation if we're to meet the needs of the population. The expert panel's report, alongside the Sir Liam Donaldson and Transforming Your Care reports, has been instrumental in developing Health and Wellbeing 2026. Delivering together. And to be clear, delivering together is now the only roadmap for reform. As I've said, the case for change is universally accepted. When I addressed this Assembly in June, I spoke about the prevailing challenges that exist. By 2039, the population aged 85 and over will have increased by 157% compared to the position in 2014. Living longer is, of course, great news for us all. But as we get older, we're more likely to live with one or more long-term conditions. In addition, our health and social care needs change, and we quite rightly have higher expectations. Our health and social care system needs to change if it's to meet the needs and the expectations of a growing population. Health and wellbeing is shaped by many factors, but above by all, by our social and economic environment. And to our shame, the inequalities between health and social wellbeing outcomes across our society are stark. Where you live should not determine how long you live. A simple illustration of this is that people who live in Belfast city centre will live up to 9 years less than those living at the top of the Malone Road. I think we all should be deeply concerned by that. Across the North, the proportion of babies born with a low birth weight in the least deprived areas is lower than that in deprived. Children born in deprived areas are more likely to experience childhood obesity and to be in care. And I think it's an outrage that in 2016 your life experience may be predetermined by your social and economic circumstances. This must change, and that change must start now. Like ministers before me, I continue to increase investment in frontline services and in service developments and improvements. And this has gone some way to alleviating the pressures the system faces and the consequences for those requiring health and social care services. However, this is not enough. Our current delivery models are having an increasingly negative impact on the quality and the experience of care, and they are constraining the ability of the system to transform itself to meet 21st century health and social care needs. There are excellent examples of innovative practice, but these are often in pockets and not widespread. The reality is that the current model is unsustainable. If we continue to provide services in the same way, using the same current models of care, demand projections show that 10 years from now, the HSE will need 90% of the entire executive budget. That's 90% of the entire executive budget. Cancoria, since coming into post, I have spent much time listening to HSE staff and to users. Not only are they ready for change, they want change and they're demanding change. They are not alone. The political summit hosted by the expert panel secured a mandate for change and the principles that underpin it. We have a fresh start supported by the executive. It's not down to one minister or to one department. There is total agreement across the executive that this needs to be done. Health and Wellbeing 2026, Delivering Together, provides a roadmap for radical transformation in the way we receive health and social care services. This is not a quick fix. Given the size and the scale of the challenge, I fully expect that the transformation process will take two mandates to properly plan, implement and embed, but we must start now. In line with the Programme for Government and the Executive's Population Health Framework, Making Life Better, my overriding ambition is for all of us to lead long, healthy and active lives. Health is a human right, and I believe in universal health service based on need, free at the point of delivery. I want to see a future in which people are provided with the information, education and support to enable them to keep well in the first place. When care is needed, it should be safe and of high quality. Those who use services should be treated with dignity, respect and compassion. Staff are the system's greatest asset, and they must be empowered and supported to allow them to do what they do best. Put simply, I want to see a health and social care system which is efficient and sustainable, where best practice is the norm, and where investment is made in areas that will positively impact service users rather than prop up a failing structure. Cancoria, my vision for health and social care is ambitious. It will require whole system transformation across primary, secondary and community care, and a radical change to the way that we access services. We will work across sectors to build capacity within communities. This will allow them to develop the skills and the knowledge needed and the assets required to tackle effectively the underlying determinants of health and wellbeing. Tapping into their ideas and their energy, we will build on the support, on the real strengths that they have. We will support the development of thriving and inclusive communities. I can call you through building community capacity, developing social capital and investing in health visiting and school nursing, we can ensure that every child and young person has the best start in life and is supported to fill their potential. We will support those who are more vulnerable in our society, those living in deprivation, our older population, those with learning disabilities and mental health issues. We will help them to live the life that they want, maximise independence and maximise choice. The Early Intervention Transformation Programme is a good example of joined-up government, with the Departments of Justice, Education and Communities all working together to find ways of intervening earlier in the lives of children to improve outcomes for all our children. We will build on that success, including building the capacity of staff to work more effectively in delivering early intervention approaches. We will also strengthen the work of the existing network of family support hubs available right across the north, which show how community, voluntary and statutory organisations can work together to help families doing their best as they face the challenges of bringing up children. Improving the life chances of children and young people is a priority for me, particularly those children whom the state has taken on parental responsibility or looked after children as they are known. These children experience much worse health, social, educational and employment outcomes than generally the children would have, and this is not acceptable to me. I will expand the range of placement options and the support available to them to support their mental and emotional wellbeing, educational attainment and overall health outcomes. We must and will become better parents for these children. I can call you, when people need care and support, very often their first port of call is their GP. Primary care is the bedrock of our health and social care system, but it's still largely based on GPs working independently with limited input from other skilled professionals such as district nursing and social workers. There are many examples of how we've improved that integration, but we must go further. People don't live their lives in silos, so we shouldn't provide them in such. I will invest in our primary care services. I will put in place multidisciplinary teams embedded around general practice that will maximise the benefits that can flow from our integrated system of health and social care. Their focus will increasingly be on keeping people well in the first place and proactive management of long-term conditions. They will be equipped to identify and respond to problems earlier, whether they relate to health or social needs. These teams will include a range of disciplines, including GPs, pharmacists, district nurses, health visitors and social workers. But I'm also keen to explore new roles that are having positive impacts elsewhere, such as advanced nurse practitioners and physician associates. We need to be open to new ways of doing things, looking to approaches elsewhere, such as the model used in the Netherlands, where district nurses lead the assessment, planning and coordination of care in self-managed teams. I believe the best of this and other approaches can be adapted and even improved upon in our integrated health and social care system. I recognise the challenges in recruiting and retaining GPs, and given the importance of building multidisciplinary primary care teams, I will increase the number of GP training places to 111 per year, with 12 additional places next year and 14 beyond that the year after. Building on the increase in training numbers made earlier this year, which represents an increase of more than 70% in GP training places within a three-year period. Alongside increasing the number of GP training places, we must make sure that general practice is a key part of the medical undergraduate curriculum. To that end, funding provided for undergraduate training will be redirected to support Queen's University in increasing the percentage of undergraduate medical curriculum spent in general practice. I can also announce that 25 GPs have been accepted onto the GP retainer scheme, which was launched earlier this year. This has meant that GPs who may otherwise have been lost to general practice are attached to practices, are working in the out-of-hours service and have access to supportive continuous professional development programme and mentoring. I have initially commissioned 5 training places for an advanced nurse practitioner programme within primary care to start in February of 2017, in addition to 8 for emergency departments. I plan to at least double those numbers from September 2017 and then to incrementally grow this cadre of staff for an increased number of specialties over the next 5 years. By further extending the role of the nurse, I want to ensure that I still have sufficient nurses to continue to do the jobs that they already do so well. So I'm increasing the number of training places for new nurses by a further 100 from September 2017 to ensure that we will not be as reliant as we currently are on the international recruitment of nurses to fill vacancies in the years to come. The role of physician associates is one that I'm keen to build on, and I provided funding to support placements in primary and secondary care for an annual cohort of 20 PA students on the new postgraduate course being commenced in the University of Ulster in January 2017. I will also continue to invest in practice-based pharmacist scheme, with close to 300 pharmacists expected to be employed across the north by 2021, taking the pressure off GPs, improving the use of medicines and supporting patients. The Ask My GP online and phone triage system, which is allowing GP practices to see patients the same day when they need to be seen, will be rolled out to a further 30 practices. These investments reflect some of the recommendations of the GP-led care working group, which reported early this year, and I intend to provide a full response to the recommendations of the working group before the end of the year. We must also make use of our valuable community pharmacies much more. They have an important role to play, particularly in supporting people to keep well in the first place and use their medicines appropriately and safely. So I want to develop a new framework for how we work with community pharmacy to realise their full potential. Mr Speaker, there has been a long-standing ambition to shift more health and social care from hospitals to settings closer to people's homes. I believe this is the right thing to do, and I want to ensure that we realise that ambition. New models and services continue to develop and emerge, such as acute care at home. For example, in the Belfast and South Eastern Trust, 460 frail elderly people have received enhanced or acute care at home services, avoiding 4,102 days in hospital. I want to ensure that patient-centred initiatives like this are implemented right across our health and social care system. Ambulatory assessment and treatment centres are a further example of innovative patient-focused initiatives which I plan to develop further. These centres will provide a one-stop shop, allowing patients to be assessed, diagnosed and, if required, receive a treatment or procedure all in the one day. In the Belfast Trust, in the past 6 months, over 9,000 patients have been treated in ambulatory care instead of waiting in the emergency department, and 81% of those were discharged home without needing to be admitted. Over 4,000 have received treatment on a planned basis through this approach without needing a stay in hospital. In the southeastern area, over 1,000 patients have benefited from this approach in the last 6 months. This and similar models in other trusts provide for a better experience for patients and a more effective use of our inpatient beds, and we need to build on the new services and expand their use. I can call you, given the changes that I have set out for the rest of the system, it follows that the nature and focus of our acute hospitals will change. As well as enhancing the support received in primary care, we need to reform and reconfigure our hospital services. The expert panel has provided us with a roadmap to do so, and I plan to consult on the criteria recommended by them next month. Once agreed, this will form the basis of a programme of service reviews, seeking to ensure our services are configured and built around what people need. This is not a stand and start. We have recently conducted clinically led reviews in pathology and imaging, and I intend to move to public consultation on these two important areas. In the future, the role of our hospitals will fundamentally change to focus on addressing the needs of patients requiring complex planned surgery or emergency care in an inpatient setting. There is strong evidence that concentrating specialist procedures and service in a small number of sites produces significantly better outcomes. Adopting this approach will mean that not every service will be available in every existing hospital, but where those services exist, each and every one of us will benefit from more timely, safer and better outcomes. Over the last few years, we have seen the development of very successful regional networks for a number of specialist services. These provide services to our whole population rather than to a small locality. And increasingly, we've seen that developed on an all-island basis, as in the case of Congenital Heart Disease Network. I have already commenced a programme of work with counterparts in the Department of Health in the South to identify areas of mutual benefit and to develop more cross-border and all-island services. I am keen to explore the potential benefits of this approach, particularly around delivering better perinatal services and support for new mothers, as well as considering ways we can help young people struggling with mental health and addiction problems. Evidence also shows that delivering both planned and emergency care using the same facilities and resources can have an adverse impact on activity and therefore leads to an increase in waiting times. Far too often, scheduled appointments and surgeries may be cancelled when vital resources are diverted to deal with unscheduled care. Moving forward, elective care centres will be developed to carry out less complex and planned treatments. These centres will make better use of the resources we have through organising them differently. This may mean that a patient may travel further for your treatment, but there is strong evidence that elective care centres, such as those used in Scotland, can reduce waiting times and can provide better experience for both staff and for patients. I can't tell you where these centres will be or how many we will have. The answer to those questions will be for the clinicians and the professional managers within the HSE system to develop evidence, to develop based on the evidence of what people need, and working in partnership with service users and patient groups. However, elective care centres are not the sole solution to the unacceptable delays currently facing patients. Rather, they are part of a long-term process moving towards a more sustainable model. This future model cannot succeed if it inherits the unacceptable waiting lists that blight our system currently. Urgent and sustained action is therefore required to bring these under control. In light of the recommendations set out in the expert panel's report, I intend to bring forward a strategy to reduce waiting lists. Concordia, I have set out the changes I believe appropriate for the services, for the delivery of services, but how we plan and manage these services is just as important. We need to reduce bureaucracy, to make the decision-making process more streamlined, and importantly, to plan and manage services in a way that promotes collaboration, integration and improvement in service delivery. In the context of the decision to close the Health and Social Care Board, I know from speaking to staff that they are anxious about their future. They have already been involved in the design process and that will continue. This is a priority for me, and now that the direction of travel has been fixed for the delivery of services, I will move very quickly on this matter and I will engage with the board staff as a matter of priority. Concordia, I believe the approach we take to transformation is as important as the transformation itself. From the outset, I was clear that this vision could only be achieved through partnership working and through co-production. It's of no coincidence that the document I am publishing today is called Delivering Together. Delivering Together sets out in clear terms how I would bring forward transformation. We all have a stake in the health and social care system. It belongs to us all, and therefore we all have a responsibility to work together to ensure it is sustainable for the future. We must all work in partnership to design and deliver the changes. The principle of co-production will underpin how we operate in the future. Whether that be at a system level, designing how our services and hospitals should be configured, or at a service level, designing how care pathways and individuals' care should be delivered differently. But also, and very importantly, it signals a collaborative approach between the people who provide services and the people that depend on them. Care should be planned around the individual and the unique needs of that person, and this must be based on real and meaningful partnership. Our mental health recovery colleges are an excellent example of the benefits that can be realised through co-production. Recognising and using the expertise that people with mental difficulties have, we will now harness the energies of people who use all of our services. I want to align the quality improvement and regulation far more closely to the voice of those who use our service and those who deliver them. We will replace a culture of targets and blame with one that focuses on outcomes and improvements. Outcomes should be shaped by what matters to people, not just what's wrong with them, and improvements will be led by staff in the front line, not by distant officials. This is already happening. Committed staff, working with the people they serve, are taking forward initiatives to improve outcomes, shorten waiting times and reduce bureaucracy. Quality improvement initiatives such as the Integrated Respiratory Service in the West are happening every day, designed and led by staff on the ground. The Community Respiratory Team provide patients with joined-up specialist support focused on self-management and coordinated care. This is a much more streamlined and responsive service for patients, GPs and hospital services, benefit and all. Another example is the Rapid Assessment Interface and Discharge Team in the Northern Area, or RAID as it's known. This innovative project is based on international best practice and recognises the links between good mental health and good physical health. Instead of the traditional approach to mental health referrals for people who come into emergency departments or being admitted to hospital, this team operates 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, to respond quickly to need. It also acts as a link to community mental health services, promoting recovery and wellbeing, and ensures continuous care and better outcomes. These are strong local examples. However, they raise the question of why these services aren't available to all of the people of the North. I want to develop a system that will learn from such approaches and see them adopted across the system as a whole. As a first step towards this, I have asked that a group is convened of professionals and people who use services to establish an improvement institute. This will not be a new building or a new layer in our system, but will help bring existing experience and knowledge together to work in a different, new way for much greater impact. This will be supported by a new approach to learning and team working. Rather than concentrating power at the top, I want all those working in health and social care to feel able to affect change and improvement in care. We must support and equip teams to do what they do best, provide excellent care, not micromanage them and load them down with unnecessary bureaucracy. This means having greater collective clinical and professional leadership throughout the HSC, supported by skilled and able managers. Too often I've heard that the current culture in the HSC is characterised by competition and silos, and that must change. I want to see a culture where staff feel empowered, where collaboration and partnership working defines the way things are done. The positive results of this way of working are clear to all. In one of our trusts, the head and neck cancer specialist nurse introduced a follow-up telephone aftercare service through working in partnership with patients, which has resulted in a patient-led follow-up service which enables fast-track referral to follow-up clinics. And there are many more examples across the system, but this type of working needs to become the new norm. For that to happen, our staff need to be equipped with the tools that would allow them to lead change. And that is why I've asked my officials to develop a system-wide HSC leadership strategy to be produced by next summer. I'm determined to realise the potential that modern information technology provides. The pace of technological change is rapid, and this is no different in the health and social care. I want to ensure that the right information is available to the right professionals, or indeed the service user themselves, when they need it and in the way that they need it. We have too many systems, and often someone will have to tell their story or provide the same information over and over again. This is at best frustrating and at worst unsafe. I want to ensure the double and triple handling of information ceases by consolidating our patient records and enabling greater access to citizens and freeing up health professionals' time to care. This is a major undertaking. Even starting now, it will be a decade before we see real change right across our HSE system. But progress is being made. Every day, more health and social care information and resources are added to ANI Direct, and I expect to have a patient portal in place for dementia patients next year. We plan to roll out online access to health and social care records over the next 5 years, where service users and patients want this. As users of the service, information about us belongs to us. Having access to that information will help make informed choices about our lives. Ken Corlea, this morning I have set out what I believe to be a very ambitious vision for the future of HSE. What I'm proposing is not a quick fix, but a significant and radical programme of change. That is why I've been upfront about the time frame. But I want to be really clear, the size and the task of the task and the length of the journey will not dictate the pace of change. I have witnessed myself the pressure that staff are under every day. I know that 10 years is too long for them to see a difference. That is why I have set out my priority actions for the next 12 months. Change starts today. I am committed to taking a personal role in this process and will bring progress reports to this Assembly every 6 months. In short, Cancorlia, I'm up for this. Of course, change cannot happen without investment. We need to continue to deliver existing HSE services to those who need it, whilst developing and implementing change, so a period of double running will be necessary. Once I begin the process of co-production, I will be clearer about the financial requirement of what I can say here, but what I can say here today is that additional investment is obviously needed. I acknowledge the cost of transformation may be significant, but standing still is not an option. There are consequences if we don't deliver planned and managed change in our health and social care system. Even with the best efforts of all the staff, waiting lists will continue to grow, expertise will continue to be diluted, and the best possible outcomes for our citizens will not be realised. It's my belief that we have been given a fresh start. We are facing into a time of change, but it's change that must happen. Delivering Together sets out a direction of travel that I hope all of our society can embrace and support in the challenging but potentially rewarding times ahead. As Minister for Health, I will provide the leadership that's needed to drive change. I have no doubt that those working in the frontline service will not be found wanting in terms of leading transformation of the health and social care system. And today, I hope that colleagues from all political persuasions will show the political leadership, the courage that's needed to support the system in transforming itself. Together, we can deliver the health and wellbeing outcomes that all of our people deserve. I commend the statement to the Assembly. Cancorlia.
Members, before I call the first person to ask a member to ask a question, I inform the House that there are a very large number who have indicated their desire to ask a question. I would therefore ask that those who do ask a question or get the opportunity to ask a question, that in order that I can get as many in as possible, that indeed that the question is short, sharp, focused, and indeed that it is relevant to the statement made by the Minister today. I call Ms. Joanne Dobson.
Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her statement and the eventual publication of the two reports. The Minister talks about a period of double running and that she'll be clear about the finance when this begins. Does she recognise that TYC failed because of the lack of budgets? So what assurances can she provide to the public, patients and health professionals that this report will not fail? And was the Minister surprised by the apparent limited detail contained within the Systems Not Structures report?
Well, I want to start by actually commending the expert panel for the work which they did. I think what the report they produced was very clear. It very clearly pointed out the stark challenges which we have in our system. I think it was a very detailed and meaningful piece of work. It engaged staff right across the whole of the health and social care system. So I very much welcome the report. I think it's allowed to inform me in terms of the direction of travel which we need to take. I believe that in going forward, we have no choice but to transform our health and social care system. And if we're all invested in making sure that we have better outcomes for the population, then we all should get in part and get on board in terms of the transformation journey which we need to take. We have an executive who has endorsed a plan of action for going forward. We have an executive who realised that transformation costs money. We have an executive that wants to deliver better outcomes for our population. So the clear direction of travel I believe that we have set out today shows that we're going to make a meaningful difference. We have to transform the system. We have to support those staff who are doing an excellent job every day, who are under pressure. So I think what we've set out today is a very clear programme for implementation, for change, to make things better, to deliver better outcomes, and we should be so focused on making sure that we deliver the best possible outcomes for all of the population. I think we have a real opportunity. A real opportunity to make a meaningful difference and a real opportunity to be world leaders in terms of what we provide here in our health and social care system. We already are the envy of many, many other areas who look towards our integrated system. So let's build on what's good. Let's transform the system. Let's put our health service on a sustainable footing. And I believe the rewards will be seen in the years and years to come when we can say that we can stand over what we have as a first-class health and social care system where staff and patients and carers are all involved in the planning, the production and the design of the services that we provide.
Call the Chair of the Health Committee, Ms. Paula Bradley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Can I also thank the Minister for her statement outlining her vision for health and social care? And I believe your vision is very ambitious, though I do believe it is achievable with consensus in the House. The Minister mentions in her statement that tough decisions need to be made and also the Bengoa criteria. Can the Minister tell the House the process she intends to put in place to involve local communities, frontline staff and political representatives to make this a reality? And can the Minister also advise what preliminary work has been done to cost these proposals set out in your statement?
I thank the member for her positive contribution, and I look forward to working with you as chair of the Health Committee. I think that we have a shared interest here to deliver better outcomes for our population, and I think we have a real opportunity, and I know that you're going to be happy to work with me in terms of making sure we deliver first-class service. I think that we shouldn't start the conversation about money. Obviously, money is very important. We need money to transform the system. But this is at the principle of all this. It's about transforming services to deliver better health outcomes for the population. So whilst I'm very obviously deeply committed to universal healthcare, free at the point of delivery for all the population, the executive for the first time ever has, as a collective, endorsed this programme of action, endorsed the plan for going forward, and in doing so recognises that there's a cost. We will obviously enter into the budget process in the weeks and months ahead, and I hope that we will secure the necessary transformation funding which we will require. I think the other point you talked about is in relation to how we're going to work and build confidence in the system. I think that's about meaningful engagement. That's about actually really listening to the staff. It's about really listening to patients. And I think it's about making sure the decisions that we take are clinician-led. And if things are clinician-led, people will know it's about better health outcomes for them. I think it's just about a frank and honest conversation with individuals about this is the plan where we need to go. We want you to help us to deliver the services. And I think people are up for that. The staff that I'm engaging with are up for that. Patients that I'm engaging with are up for that. So I personally am going to embark on a process of engagement and go out into anywhere where health service staff want to talk to me about getting involved in the conversation and make sure that we collectively take forward this, go on this journey. But I also believe it's about genuine ownership, giving staff and patients ownership of the direction that we're going to take.
Call Ms. Catherine Seeley.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her statement today and welcome the work that has gone on behind the scenes to get us to today. Can I ask the Minister, she has made it clear in the past that mental health is a priority of hers. Can't you set out her plans in relation to mental health and how we can achieve a parity of esteem for mental health?
Again, I thank the member for her question, and I have said in this House on many occasions, and I've said since taking up office, that mental health will be one of my key priorities. I think that in terms of how we reshape services, again, in terms of co-production and how we look towards the future of how we're going to deliver services, mental health is actually one of those areas through recovery colleges where we can actually see how co-production works. So I want to do more of that. I think that we have to work towards the point where we have parity esteem for mental health, which to me means recognising that the true impact of mental illness on society, it's about a focus on recovery, it's about greater involvement of our experts by experience. It's about, so that's the service user and those that are living with mental illness. It's about investing in service developments where resources allow, and it's about finally exploring the potential for all island developments. And I said in the statement, there's a number of areas where I think we could work more collaboratively, particularly perinatal mental health and in relation to young people who find themselves with dual diagnosis. I think that there is so much which we have still to do. I'm going to receive the review of the Bamford Report Action Plan in the next month, and that's going to help me inform the direction of travel. And what I want to do is set out very clearly a plan of action for the next number of years, how we're going to achieve that party of esteem for mental health. It's so important that we help people to remain well. It's so important that we promote positive mental health messages. So I want to prioritise this, and as I said, I will produce over the next number of months a plan actually how we're going to take it forward.
Call Mr. Mark Durkin.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I very much thank the Minister for her statement and welcome the publication of this report that does contain some extremely sensible and necessary proposals. However, the lack of specifics in the report and in the statement when it comes to the transformation or rationalisation of our hospital estate means that a spectre of doubt will loom over services in several areas. When will the Minister be in a position to put more meat on the bones of this statement and let us know what this means for where?
Well, you see, we didn't just arrive at this scenario overnight. The Health Service didn't get this data in overnight. This has been a process that happened over many, many years. And it's for a number of reasons. Ageing population, growing expectation, growing demand, financial challenges, the Tories cutting the block grant, all the implications for all of that. So I could list the challenges, which are well rehearsed and I think universally accepted. So we have to get better about how we deliver services. And I think that what I've set out this morning is a true reflection of the length of time that it's going to take us to properly transform the system. There is no quick fix. So I think what we need to have is a sustained plan of action, which is what I've clearly set out. But I don't think that we don't just sit back and wait for 10 years' time and see what's happened. We have to actually be part of everyday actions that are making a difference. I've clearly set out my plan of action for the next 12 months, which is very much focused on co-production and co-design. It's very much if I'm serious about co-production and actually delivering services in conjunction with patients, with carers and with staff, then I shouldn't run too far ahead of the ball, because that wouldn't be meaningful collaboration, it wouldn't be meaningful engagement. So what I've set out clearly is a plan of action for the next 12 months, which is going to form the year after and the year after and the year after, and I see what we will see is incremental change. I would suggest to the member that we shouldn't allow any seed of doubt to be sown out there. This is a positive development. We all want to see better health outcomes for all of the population, so the best way we can do that is to work together. I've said I'd come back to this House every 6 months to write this journey, to update the members on where we're at and how far we've gotten our progress. So I think this is different. This is different than anything that's come before. We have an executive that has put their full weight behind this direction of travel. We have an executive that realises that we need to have additional funding to transform. We have an executive that wants to tackle waiting lists, and I have said that I'm going to bring forward a plan in January, which will actually set out very clearly over the next 5 years how we're going to bring those waiting lists down. But that's a plan of action to deal with the backlog. But if we don't transform the system, the waiting list picture isn't getting any better. Staff are going to become under even more pressure. So I would suggest to all the members of the House, this is a positive day. This is a fresh start for health, and we should go out and be committed and tell the public that we are committed to delivering this transformation. I, as the Health Minister, will not be found wanting in terms of the leadership which I'm going to show to drive forward meaningful transformation, because I am committed to tackling health inequalities and delivering first-class health outcomes for all of the population.
Well, Ms. Paula Bradshaw.
Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister. I think the reports are very good, and they very much reflect what we as Health Committee members have been hearing over the last few months. I would draw your attention to the increase in the GP places to 111, and that's very much to be welcomed. However, as you know, the BMA and the Royal College of GPs have got a lot of urgent pressing matters that need to be attended to, not just around more places, and I'm talking specifically around more finances. How do you plan in the shorter term to address the issues around finances?
I mean, we all recognise that GPs are under pressure, and I think that the focus which I've put today in relation to primary care is going to really, really help improve that picture and really help to support GPs. The fact that within the next number of months all GP surgeries will have a named health visitor, district nurse and social worker, that in itself shows the commitment to multidisciplinary teams, which is something that obviously BMA and GPs are asking for. I think the other things around working with community pharmacy, that is something that I think that our community pharmacists can do so much more, and they're crying out to do so much more. So I want to work with them, and I've set out that I will develop the framework over the next number of months again with them. And I think that in terms of whenever we come to agree a new community pharmacy contract, we can actually work more collaboratively with community pharmacy also. I think that a combination of building community capacity, all these things are going to make a real difference to primary care. Because I think whenever it comes to making difficult decisions in the future about, you know, where services are based, you have to invest in primary care. People have to feel that it's different in the primary care. I think the initiatives which we've set out today are going to do that. The GP-led working group has obviously set out a number of asks, some of which we have addressed here today, but I will respond by the end of the year to the full report, and we'll look at other areas where we can work together. Primary care is GPs, or the bedrock, I suppose, of primary care. So I think this is a good opportunity for us to not just have a nod to primary care. This is actually about real, meaningful difference. So I think the implementation of some of the initiatives which I've set out will make a real, real difference.
Call Mr. Gary Middleton.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for outlining this report today. The expert panel report says that action must be taken to address elective care waiting times. The Minister stated that she intends to bring forward a strategy to try and address and reduce the waiting times. Can the Minister outline what content she foresees in this strategy?
I thank the Member for his question. I consistently say it, and I say it again here today, that the waiting times are unacceptable. They're unacceptable to me, and they're unacceptable, I think, to all of us, and we can share that. I understand absolutely that if you're waiting to be seen as an individual or as a parent or as a daughter or as a son, it's so stressful and worrying if you can't get to see someone as quickly as possible. So I think we need to do two things. We need to address the backlog that's there, and that's what the plan will very much be about. But alongside that, what we need to do is develop and transform our system so that we don't get to this point. And I think that's new ways of working. I think what we're trying to do is operate a 20th century health and social care system, trying to deliver 21st century care, and those two things don't marry up. So if we don't transform a system, our waiting lists aren't going to get any better. So I have already done a large body of work in relation to waiting lists and bringing forward a plan. And we're going to need additional funding to be able to do that. But I think that we have to, in order to, I think, build public confidence in the, what we're doing is the right thing, we need to address the waiting list alongside the transformation piece. So in the time ahead, I think that transformation is the longer term solution. In the meantime, we're going to have to bring forward that plan, which I'm going to do by January, which will clearly set out over the next 5 years how we're going to try and bring down the waiting list.
Call Mr. Ian Milne.
Wickas Foster, Don Ira, Don Riches for Kenya, and Riches Shaw, or imagine. Thanks, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for her statement this morning, and I thank her for that. Our community pharmacies are providing vital services every day. Can the Minister explain how she plans to utilise them better in order to help deliver the vision and changes she has set out before us here today? Gurumugat.
Again, I thank the member for his question, and I absolutely 100% agree. I think that community pharmacies play a vital role in our health and social care system. And recently, whenever I was out visiting one of the community pharmacies, I could see it firsthand how they contribute, and things that you wouldn't even believe that a pharmacy does. They quite often can be the first port of call for a lot of people, particularly in deprived areas. People are more maybe likely to go to their community pharmacist than often to their GP. So they're crying out to want to do more. I want to work with them to do more. Our community pharmacies dispense over 40 million prescription items every year, and they have unequalled access to people in local communities, which I think then gives them the opportunity to promote wellbeing, to be through the best use of medicines and deliver important support about healthy lifestyles. I also think that whenever we look towards winter, pharmacy in the community has a critical role in supporting people to stay well and to make informed choices about HSE services. So I want to maximise the potential of community pharmacy. They're up for it, I'm up for it, and I think that we can make a real positive difference. And that will, again, this is all bringing it back to the focus on primary care. It's about the GP, it's about the district nurses, it's about the allied health professionals, it's about the social worker, it's about the community pharmacist, it's about the community itself, and it's about that partnership and collaborative working. And I think that if we successfully get to that point, then we'll see real meaningful differences in terms of, particularly in relation to tackling health inequalities, and making sure we're reaching people at a very early stage. Early intervention and prevention are absolutely key when it comes to the health service.
Call Mr. George Robinson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And can I thank the Minister for her statement. Can the Minister outline the timescale for the additional GPs retraining to impact on the front line of out-of-hours care in areas such as the Western out-of-hours, where at times in towns such as Limavady there's occasions no GP service between 8:30 in the evening and maybe 8:30 the next morning?
Yeah, I've outlined a number of areas where we're going to work with GPs, and that's obviously recruiting, the increase in the number of GPs training places, but also it's about looking at associate physicians and what role they can play. I think that we need to explore new ways of working, and I've announced some moves in relation to that. Also, I think, you know, advanced practitioner nurses, there's not a lot more people can support the GP in that setting. So I think we need to move to the point where we truly have these multidisciplinary teams in place. GPs are under pressure, particularly in rural areas. We've seen example of some particular challenges in relation to that. So I'm committed to increasing the numbers of, I think it's 12 next year and 20 or 14 the year after in terms of GP places. But I think that we also have seen in the last year an investment package of up to 5.1 million in 15-16, and then a further 7 million this year. So we're continuing to work with GPs. We have increased the number of GP places, but I will respond in due course to the recommendations of the GP-led care working group in the context of the GP context of the budget process.
Call Mr. Robbie Butler.
I thank the Minister for her answer so far, and indeed the report. And the Minister thought it important enough to mention extending the role of nurses and midwives. And recommendation number 3 talks about innovative approaches. I would hope that she'd agree that that's not an innovative approach. And it's more doing more for doing more for less. And with that extension and role that she talks about, will she also recognise that an additional responsibility payment may be required for those people and commit to recognise that our nurses and midwives and care staff are appreciated and treated fairly?
Well, what I was talking about, innovative approaches, are supporting the staff to do what they do well. And I pointed out a number of examples where staff have went on ahead, developed innovative practices, and I think we need to scale those up. If something works, let's just do it across the board. Quite often, a lot of these innovative projects and initiatives that staff have taken are done in pockets, but we should just replicate it across the whole of the North. That's something that works. So for me, what I want to do and what I've clearly set out I'm going to do is a workforce strategy plan. We don't have a workforce strategy plan right across health and social care. So if we want to transform a system, then we also need to look at what our workforce challenges are. So I've set out that I'm going to take forward that programme of work, and that for me will allow us to make sure we have the right staff, trained in the right way, and the right specialism that we need. And I think it is innovative to look towards more areas, for example, advanced practitioner nurses, to look towards physician associates, to look towards supporting the staff to do, as I said, the excellent work which they do. So try not to be too critical. I think this is a good day for health. We should embrace it and take it on board as such.
Call Ms. Linda Dillon.
Can the Minister thank the Minister for her answer so far, and can the Minister outline how her vision set out in delivering together will help address the health inequalities that currently exist?
Well, I think that this is one of the things that Professor Bengoa picks up on his report, and then I went on to also highlight it. The health inequalities which we face are stark, and I don't think we should ever be comfortable with that picture. But I do believe that in tackling health inequalities, the only way we can do that is cross-working, collaborative working. I think the new programme for government approach allows us to do that. I think it's not right that, you know, where you live should determine what your outcomes are going to be in life. But we know that is the case. We know that deprivation is linked to health outcomes, or in terms of job choices, employment, housing. I think we need to tackle all of those things. The vision which I have set out in Delivering Together is focused on keeping well, people well in the first place, and providing the education, the information and the support that people need to make informed choices regardless of where they live. I think that by building the capacity in our multidisciplinary teams in primary care, ensuring there's a named health visitor, district nurse and social worker for every GP practice, then they will be better equipped to respond earlier and work with people to address lifestyle choices that impact on health and wellbeing. I also think that if we continue, and what I've outlined is investment in community development resources, we will work with our partners and other communities to help all of the community to help them to develop the strengths and the assets that to tackle the determinants of health and wellbeing. We have to tackle the root causes of health inequalities, and we have to take that head on. We no longer can tolerate the links between deprivation, the correlation between deprivation and people's health outcomes. So I believe that we can truly judge our system whenever we improve that picture. And I think the direction of travel which we're going to take will very much lead to improving that.
Call Mr. Gordon Dunn.
Mr. Speaker, and I too thank the Minister for her report on what is a very important issue and long awaited. How does the Minister see improvements to patient flow within our hospital system, as bed blocking has been a critical issue with a serious knock-on effect through the system, as patients in many cases await for community care packages?
I think that we can see again some innovative practices where they have been able to improve patient flow, but particularly in times of winter, for example, our EDs get full and patient flow is very difficult. We quite often can't see older people discharged from hospital because there's no domiciliary care package in place, and there are particular challenges in relation to the workforce there. One of the things, in December, I think it is, I'm going to receive the report of the review of domiciliary care, and I passionately believe in domiciliary care. I believe that these people they're mostly women, they're the lowest paid people in our health service. Quite often the trusts are contracting out the work to independent providers. These people don't get any mileage. So if you work in a rural area and you have to go from one person's house to another, it could be 20 miles of difference in between, and no mileage, you're already low wages, you're taken down even further. So we need to support these people and help them with professional development, with their own development, and I'm committed to doing that. I look forward to getting the report, but certainly I'm passionate about making sure that we do more to support domiciliary care workers to make sure that because they support the system. They support the system, they keep people at home longer, and people can be discharged quicker from hospital if they happen to be there. So I look forward to that. Also, alongside that, in March, we're going to go out to consult on the review of adult social care. And again, I think that will also allow us to improve how we deliver services and make sure that we have the appropriate settings to care for people and that they're adaptable, because not everybody fits into the one approach. So that's very much going to be the conversation in relation to that.
Call Mr. Colin McGrath.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and I thank the Minister for the report here today. The statement that you made does make suggestions that there may need to be some change or indeed some closure to emergency departments, and often it is the rural communities that are impacted by these changes the most. But yet I note that your statement today makes no reference, and I think the reports from what I've skimmed make little reference to the ambulance service and the vital role that they play in delivering that front line of care to people in their moment of need. Can you make some comment as to whether the ambulance service would receive additional resources as part of this programme?
Well, the ambulance service obviously play a key role in terms of our health and social care, and actually have been very progressive themselves in terms of the new initiatives which they've brought forward, particularly whenever they arrive at hospital with a patient, that they're not sitting for long times waiting to be able to drop the patient off at the hospital into the care of a clinician. So I think we need to do more of that, and certainly in terms of the workforce planning, some of the challenges we have in relation to ambulance service or in relation to workforce. When it comes to workforce planning, we will look at every element of the health and social care system, including ambulance staff, to make sure that we have proper workforce planning and that we meet the needs of the service. So I'm committed to working with the ambulance service. The report itself doesn't talk about the ambulance service, but they're an integral part of the HSE system, so we need to work with all elements of the system. You talked about closures. I think we need to frame the conversation in what is the best outcome for individuals, what delivers the best possible health outcomes for individuals. So I think the report that Professor Bengoa and the expert panel took forward very regularly focused on delivering better systems, not structures. He didn't focus on structures. Because I could have spent the next 5 years focused on structures, but the outcomes wouldn't have changed. So I believe if you get the system right, structures will change in time. And I think that if we invest in primary care, and people can see a real difference in terms of what you can get in your community. Because let's remember, the traditional model of going to hospital isn't 21st century models of health and social care. It's recognition out there that we need to do things differently. People want to stay at home. So we should support people to stay at home as long as possible. Only those that are acutely ill or for emergency reasons should be in our hospitals. So if we work towards that and people can see a real difference in terms of what the support we provide in communities, acute care at home is a really, really fine example, I believe, of how that works. People actually get into people's homes, all the staff and clinicians get into people's homes and supporting them to stay in their own bed at night, and that can make a big difference to someone who's not well. So for me, it's about doing more of that, and then our structures will change in time, but let's invest in the primary care. That's what certainly my vision outlines of what I want to do.
Call Mr. Alex Maskey.
I guess Colin Cole, could I thank the Minister for her very important statement this morning. Could I ask the Minister, where does she think that there is any further potential to deliver specialised services on an all-island basis?
Yeah, I think there's definitely areas where we can build upon some of the collaboration that already exists, particularly in relation to children's cardiac services and also in relation to the radiotherapy for cancer patients, shows that we've been able to develop really innovative services for the population on the island, which benefits obviously patients but also benefits staff, because they're allowed to specialise in areas where they wish to. I think there's so many more opportunities, such as transplantation of organs and rare diseases. We've also developed a programme of work with the Department of Health in the South to identify other areas of mutual benefit, and I set out in the statement areas where I think we could collaborate more. I think in relation to mental health, I think that perinatal mental health in particular, there's no service in this island to support women in pregnancy with mental illness, and I think that I would be very proud if we were able to deliver a service as such, and I think we could do it collaboratively across the island and allow us to develop it a lot more quicker than perhaps we could do individually. I think also in relation to recent conversations I've had in relation to dual diagnosis and young people, adolescents with mental health problems but also with addiction problems, I think that we again don't have any sort of service right across the island. So there are just two areas, but there are three areas, including transplantation, I think, of potential areas for scope, but there's a scope of study ongoing, and I look forward to receiving that. And I want to take forward measures which allow us to develop services that allows we get first-class services for the population.
Call Mr. Stephen Farry.
Speaker, and also thank the Minister for her statement. She has referred to welcoming the report and also commending Professor Bengoa and his colleagues for their work, but she hasn't taken the opportunity to systematically go through the recommendations in her statement or her documentation and to give her response. And it is traditional for ministers, whenever they receive reports, to give their view on the report as a whole. So for the avoidance of any doubt, can the Minister clarify, is she fully accepting the report in its entirety that has been presented by Professor Bengoa, or if she's not, what aspects is she not accepting?
Well, I can assure the member that I am, and I believe I said that in the outset. I said that I endorse the recommendations which the expert panel have put forward. I said that very clearly, I think, in the first opening paragraph. So, well, let me say it to you again in case you missed it. I'm endorsing the expert panel's report, and I have set out my plan of action as to how I'm going to take those things forward.
Call Mr. Danny Kennedy.
Can I refer the minister to action point number 12 in the report, page 26, under the heading transformation. And the action point that says, establish and seek members of a transformation oversight structure with membership drawn from within and out with the HSC, and that's to be targeted by or during November 2016. Can the minister outline what would be the size of the structure? How many members will it have? Who will appoint those members? Will it be practitioners, academics, politicians? And how will it avoid duplication of those with existing responsibility?
What's very clear is that we have to drive the change. I'm going to provide the political leadership for change, but I think that we need clinician-led oversight in terms of service reconfiguration. So I've clearly set out that next month, so next November's next week, so over the next couple of weeks, I intend to set out what that panel will look like. But suffice to say, I think it needs to be clinician-led. It also needs to include people from inside and outside the health and social care system. So I'm working up the detail of that, and we'll announce that in the coming weeks. But it's so important. We can have a lovely direction of travel, but we have to drive the implementation. I will drive it politically, but I'm asking for clinicians. I remember whenever I first came into office, I was speaking at an event somewhere, and my message to the health service was, help me to help you. And that's again my message that I'm going to leave with today, leave your answer today. It's about how I can help the health service to do more, how I can support them to deliver the first-class service which they're committed to delivering. And I think that the direction of travel we've set out here is the correct one. I think it's going to hopefully command universal acceptance. But what I think what we need to do, for the first time ever, recognise that this executive has endorsed this plan. This executive is committed to delivering and tackling waitlists. This executive is committed to delivering better outcomes for the population. And that, to me, is how we should be measured. Because in government, you take tough decisions, and in government, you deliver better outcomes for the whole of the population.
Call Mr. Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and thanks to the Minister for her statement. I welcome it, and the acknowledgement that the health service is a breaking point. The Minister in her statement has also noted a change or a need for change in the configuration of acute services. Does the Minister at this stage have any information on where regional services will be provided, especially those in the Western Trust?
You can't help but be parochial. No, what I've said I'm going to do, the expert panel has set out criteria which they believe should lead and be considered whenever it comes to service reviews. The expert panel also set out very clearly that we can't keep delivering every service in every hospital. The panel also set out that we need to specialise in services. That's good for patients, it's good for patient outcomes, but it's also good for the staff because they get to build their skills and their knowledge. So I think that when it comes to where we're going in the direction of travel, today isn't about closures, it's not about hospitals. This is about changing the picture, this is about better health outcomes. So what does that mean? Does it mean you travel a little bit further to get a first-class service? Does it mean that if you, for example, had a stroke and you travel 20 minutes extra, but your outcomes are better, you'll live longer, your mobility won't be as reduced, your speech and language will be better? I think then people are prepared to do that. I listened this morning to Janet Smith from the Royal College of Nurses, and she clearly said that people will travel if they are getting a first-class service. But we have to allow people need to understand why you make changes. So that's why I want to communicate with staff, communicate with patients, carers and families, to make sure that we are all part of designing the services, that people understand the care pathways, that they understand why they travel to get services. So let's not focus today on closures, let's focus today on building a first-class health and social care system. But the criteria will, in terms of service reviews, will be out to consultation over the next number of weeks. And I look forward to receiving members' views in terms of agreeing those, and then let's just get on with service reviews and making sure that we design a first-class health and social care system.
Call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. I want to welcome the Minister's commitment to parity for mental health with physical health, but also Challenger. Parity will only have real meaning if she addresses the imbalance in funding and resource. Will she commit to that over this 10-year period?
Well, maybe the member misunderstands what party of esteem is. Party esteem does not mean giving the same amount of resource to physical health and mental health. Party esteem, well, the Royal College of Psychiatrists clearly say that in their report, in their ask for party of esteem to be established. When I talk about party of esteem, I'm talking about moving towards true recognition, attention of resource, attention of the department's attention to the mental health issue. So I think when we focus more on recovery, when we focus more on promoting good, positive mental health messages, whenever we invest in service developments, whenever we do more for perinatal health, whenever we review the Bamford Action Plan, and actually I set out a plan for the next 5 years, I think then you'll be able to see how we are going to deliver party of esteem. I'm very much committed to doing that, and I think that all the members of the House would actually share that aspiration. I think for far too long, mental health hasn't had the attention that it deserves, and it's something that blights all of our communities. And those people who find themselves very vulnerable with mental health issues need to be supported.
Call Mr. Gerry Mullen.
Can I, Mr. Speaker, as a follow-up to Mr. Middleton's question in terms of elective care, could I ask the Minister that, as far as elective care centres are concerned, would she intend to increase capacity here, especially with new capital bill projects within the public sector, other than a total reliance on the private sector?
You know, elective care centres are within the HSE estate, so they will be developed in line with need, and they will be developed in line with, as I said in the statement, we don't know the number of them yet or where they will be placed, but the service reviews will allow us to be able to do that. I think elective care centres are really going to help us deal with the waiting list issue, because they will allow people who have been scheduled for surgery, minor surgeries perhaps, to be seen, and there will be no interruption to that service. So that in itself will bring down waiting lists in the longer term. So I think that what I've said is we'll consult on the criteria, then next year we'll move towards designing where elective care centres should go, and I think that these will make a real meaningful difference to patients' outcomes.
I call Mr. Stuart Dixon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and thank you, Minister, for your statement so far. Minister, recommendation number 6 requires additional funding for the transformation and transition. Have you secured that money from your executive colleagues?
Yes, well, the executive has endorsed the direction of travel, they have endorsed the plan, and they have endorsed it going forward. They have also, in terms of endorsement, have recognised that transition is going to take additional funding. They also endorsed the fact that in order to bring down waiting lists, it will need additional funding in the short term. So I think for a period of time, we are going to have dual running, so we have to keep the health service delivering every day alongside the transformation piece. But we can't be distracted from transformation, because if we don't, the system will be in crisis in years to come.
Called Ms. Kelly Armstrong.
Thank you very much to the Minister, and thank you very much for your statement. Going again to the recommendations, recommendation 7 refers to the creation of a transformation board. Can the Minister confirm, out with what happened with Transforming Your Care, where there was no implementation plan, that this implementation plan that's mentioned in part 5, the actions, will be followed and will be monitored regularly with published outcomes?
I am absolutely committed to moving to outcomes-based analysis, and I think that's where we need to be. Now, we'll not do that overnight, but that's certainly where we're going to be working towards. I'm going to update the House every 6 months in relation to this plan, because I think that shows that that we're serious about transformation and driving it forward. And it's also about saying to members, I want to work with you and deliver better health outcomes for all of the population. So I think that there's no danger in this falling down if there's genuine effort to implement it. And I'm going to not be found wanting in terms of my political leadership, but also the oversight structure which we put in place. Clinician-led, I think, will make a real meaningful difference in something that hasn't happened before.
Call Mr. Gerry Carroll.
Can the Minister give a guarantee this report will not lead to the further encroachment by the private sector in our NHS?
Well, obviously, I'm going to work towards a position where we don't need to use the independent sector. But in the meantime, whilst we get to that point, and it's going to take a number of years, there are a number of people who are on waiting lists who we can't just leave there. So I think we're going to have to do a combination of things in the short term. In the short term, we're going to have to make sure we're at full capacity within the health service, but also in the short term, we're going to have to use the independent sector, because I can't let patients suffer whilst we get to a transformed health and social care system. So I believe that in the short term, we are going to need the independent sector, but certainly for me, the longer term goal, universal health care, free at the point of delivery for all people who need the health and social care services, and we shouldn't have to rely on outside of the health service to deliver all those services that are much needed.
Call Mr. Jim Allister.
So here we go again. Another fresh start in health. The recycling of a great plethora of fine words from an executive that since 2011 has reduced hospital beds in our hospitals by 10% and then is surprised by the chaos that results. But the question I want to ask is, how can the minister come to this House with grand proposals that she hasn't costed? What is the costing of what the minister is proposing? And surely any proposal to be credible needs to be costed before it is embraced.
It must be exhausting being so negative all of the time. I have clearly said and set out a direction of travel. I've also said that the executive has endorsed that direction of travel in the recognition that we need additional funding. We're about to go through the budget process, and I would like to say at the other side of that budget process, we will also have a funding allocation that allows us to transform the system. So I think it's very clear. What we have here is a real roadmap for change, a real roadmap for transformation, a real roadmap that's going to deliver incremental change year on year, that's going to see staff supported, that's going to see patients supported, that's going to lead to an open and honest conversation about where we're going. So in terms of cost, I have costed everything that I'm talking about, and what I'm doing with the Minister for Finance and with my executive colleagues is working through our due process in terms of the budget decisions, and that will all become very clear to you. So don't be too worried. You'll see it all in due course.
I call Mr. Eamon McCann.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In light of the Minister's assurance that in future more attention will be paid to the perspectives and the opinions of frontline staff than to a manager sitting in an office with a spreadsheet. I paraphrase, of course. What steps will she take to ensure that we have no repetition of the grotesque situation which arose in the Western Trust area, whereby £8 million of money earmarked for learning disability services were not spent on learning disability services, and no explanation of an adequate or clear nature has been produced for this shortfall? We deserve to know this. We don't know it. Will the Minister take steps at least to ensure that there is no repetition of this happening?
In relation to the Western Trust issue, I have met with the families, the carers, and continue to do so and give them all the reassurances that we would get to the bottom of it. I think that what we seriously need to be about, and this is the core tenet of what I'm talking about, co-production and co-delivery means that. It means proper collaboration. It means people understanding, excuse me, if you make service changes, patients need to understand why you're doing it. They need to know it's about trying to provide a better service for them. They need to understand it and be given every information. So I'm certainly committed to that. I think that in terms of building capacity within communities, this co-production, co-delivery, co-design is going to be key and instrumental to helping us deliver a first-class health and social care system. I think that openness, honesty, transparency is key. I think that the trusts are up for that. I think that the department's up for that. I think that together we can, as I say, deliver first-class health and social care outcomes for all of the population. And that should be the only aspiration that I think that we all work into in relation to the health service.
Call Mr. Justin McNulty.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I thank the Minister for her report. In the publication of the Health and Wellbeing 2026 document, reference is made to ambulatory assessment and treatment centres. Can I ask the Minister, are these similar to community care and treatment centres which are planned for such places as Newry? And would an ambulatory assessment and treatment centre include a facility such as a minor injuries unit?
No, ambulatory care centres are different. Set up altogether. It allows people who, for example, a GP thinks needs to be seen by a consultant, it allows them to go into a centre. And these centres, for example, I visited one last week in the Royal, and there's one in the Manor. And one of the things that you do is if you're referred, you can have your blood tests, your x-rays, you can see the consultant, you can be assessed and watched throughout the course of the day. And quite often, as I said, the stats show that you can then be sent home. You don't actually have to be admitted to hospital. So that's the ideal. Nobody wants to be in hospital unless it's absolutely necessary. So I believe that if we could scale up the number of those ambulatory centres, and what form that takes would be different depending on where they're going to be placed. But I think that if we could scale those up, that'll make a real meaningful difference to individuals. And again, it'll prevent hospital admissions, which is what we all should be working towards. People do not want to be in hospital. So I look forward to the development of these ambulatory centres. I think they'll make a real positive difference, again, in terms of bed blockages and in terms of waiting lists.
Call Ms. Michelle Gildernew.
Ken Corla. I also welcome the Minister's statement and the publication of the report, and I think there's a lot in there that I would certainly welcome, especially in regards to mental health to children and looked after children. And the Minister is aware that there's a lot of pressure currently in the system on nurses, on social workers, on frontline staff. I very much welcome the increase in GP places, Minister. You are aware of the increase in pressure in rural areas around GP practices, particularly in Fermanagh. And in regards to an earlier question, when people are travelling further to services, don't forget the road goes both ways, so hopefully they'll be travelling west for some of them services and not us travelling east all the time. But in regards to my question, do you see the increase in GP training places having a very positive influence on the delivery of the report going forward, given that most people's point of contact is with their GP?
Yeah, I mean, I think absolutely. This is about trying to address the challenges that are there in relation to GP services, but it's very much about, as I said, building up that team. The multidisciplinary approach is going to make a real difference, I believe. I think the fact that GPs have a team around them which they can interact with each other and rely on each other, I think will make a significant difference in terms of primary care. Staff are working even harder and under a lot of pressure, so we have to get this right and we have to do it. Social workers tell me about the pressures that they're under. I constantly hear about social workers going home and having to sit to 2 o'clock in the morning writing up reports. Now, that's not sustainable for anybody's working pattern. So I want to do more to work with all of those teams to make sure the teams support each other. And also I think that we have a real opportunity to make sure the primary care is embedded, it's multidisciplinary and it's action-based, and I think it's going to be really make it change the picture. In terms of rural services, I absolutely agree that if we're going to design services, we need to make sure that people will always be happy to travel if they're getting a better health outcome. We don't want to starve. It doesn't mean everything has to centralise in Belfast, for example. It can be that services can be spread across the north. I'm not going to use examples because then people will click onto it, but there are, I think, really good innovative things that are being done in each trust, and I think each trust has a crucial role to play in terms of where we develop services and where they're safe, because what really at the core of all of this has to be patient quality and patient safety.
Call Mr. Alex Atwood.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and can I welcome the statement and also acknowledge that this is challenging work and that I think everybody recognises that the Minister is applying herself to this challenging work. There should be no doubt about that assertion. My question is about the issue of double running. If it is the case that over the lifetime of this mandate, in years 2 to 5, there will be increased health budget allocations in the existing structures, and there will be double running as the new reforms roll out, has the Executive agreed this morning, and has the Minister of Finance confirmed to you that double running will be permitted during the course of this mandate? And from years 2 to years 5, can you in broad terms indicate what the increased budget allocation will be required in order to facilitate double running?
Yeah, I mean, the Executive has recognised that we're going to need a period of double running, but the Executive obviously has to appreciate that that will not be forever. It's until we transform a system, until we put health on a sustainable footing. We don't have a choice other than to do that, because if we don't do that, the system will be in crisis and the entire block grant could be sucked up by health. And then what would you do for every other service and department and education and roads and everything else that's important to people's lives? So I think we don't have a choice. The Executive has clearly committed to the plan, and in doing so has clearly also committed to the Transformation Fund. I think that as part of the budget process in the next number of weeks and months, which the Executive is involved with, we'll see the allocation of funding, and we'll have discussions, I'm quite sure, in this chamber in relation to that at that time. But we do not have a choice. I can't say that enough. We do not have a choice. We have to transform health and social care, otherwise the system will break. The system will break at some stage in the future. So I think that the Executive, in recognition of that, are fully behind the strategy. They're fully behind a two-mandate plan. And we've never had a two-mandate plan before, and I think that's really significant in itself. It sent out a very strong political leadership message that the Executive are committed to delivering this transformation programme, alongside tackling all the immediate issues which we have.
I call Mr. Roy Beggs.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. In her statement, the Minister talks about investment in primary care. Well, my constituents from Lorne Carrick and Newton Abbey have most of their care provided from Antrim and Belfast, so I welcome that there will be greater focus on primary care. But there does need to be investment there in order that our GP practices can be improved and services provided. What investment, both in capital and in resource budgeting, will follow that to enable more services to be provided locally from our GPs and other allied professionals?
I mean, I think I've already answered that in relation to the numbers of places which we have announced in relation to GP places, in relation to more nurses, in relation to named social workers, health visitors and district nurses, in relation to rolling out more of Ask My GP to 30 more practices. So all those things come with a cost, but I have decided that I can do those things within the budget which I have set out and what I'm planning with the executive. So this is about real meaningful change. It's about investing in the front line. It's about investing in primary care. And I think that in order for us to be successful in this transformation programme, we have to do that.
Call Ms Nicola Mullen.
Thank you, Mr Speaker. The Minister will not be surprised at the content of my question, and it relates to the devastating and growing problem of mental health and addiction among our young people, not least in my own constituency of North Belfast. I wholeheartedly welcome the Minister's commitment to exploring, on a regional and on an all-island basis, specialist treatment for our young people who are struggling with mental health and addiction problems. But could I ask the Minister, could she shape further her thinking on that matter? And does it involve the provision of a specialist treatment centre or a unit for dual diagnosis, particularly those who are at the most acute end of this problem?
I can say that I'm committed to developing services along with the Minister in the South. We actually have embarked on a process of identifying areas where we can collaborate. But the issue of perinatal mental health and the issue of dual diagnosis is something that stands out to me as something where I think we can do something, because we do not have a service on this island. So we're actively just looking at what is available in the 26 counties, and then we're going to obviously develop that conversation further. I think that we need to do more to support those young people. I think that there's a lot of debate around what that would look like, and I think we need to have that conversation. I have met with yourself, I've met with Karen O'Connell, I've met with Gerry Kelly, all in relation to how we can do more, particularly given the challenges and particular recent deaths in North Belfast. So I think that for me, I'm committed to tackling mental health issues, and I'm very committed to making sure that we support our young people who find themselves in such a vulnerable situation, and making sure that the health service responds to the needs that they have.
Call Ms Carol McQuillan.
Can I call you and thank the Minister for her statement and wish her well. It's in relation to, you'll not be surprised, you just give me a name check there, mental health, and really in relation to the dual diagnosis, but also in partnership with our health and social care staff, as well as our partners and our stakeholders within the community sector. I'm aware that the Protect Life 2 strategy is out for consultation, and perhaps the Minister wants to wait until then on Bamford, but could you give us some assurance that the community and voluntary sector, our partners, will not become invisible in terms of reforming our health and social care practices?
Thank the member for her question, and I can absolutely give that assurance. I think that some of the community and voluntary sector do amazing work, and they're very engaged in all of our communities. So I think that they are absolutely part of the picture in terms of supporting all those people who find themselves with mental ill health. I think that in terms of going forward, obviously I'm consulting on Protect Life Strategy 2, the suicide prevention strategy, and I intend to personally engage in relation to that issue. It's something that I believe that we can continue to improve what's good out there, and then learn lessons where we need to. So I want to work with the community voluntary sector, and recently, you'll be aware, I think you attended it yourself, the Future Search event in Belfast, which actually looked at bringing together all the partners across the community voluntary statutory sector and looking about how collaboratively we can do more to deal with suicide in our society. So I'm very much committed to that collaboration, that partnership working, and I'm very much somebody who wants to listen to those people who are engaging with people with mental ill health day and daily in their communities at 12 o'clock at night. I know some of the commitment of some of these community voluntary sector individuals, and I really, really want to work with them in the time ahead.
Members, that concludes questions on the Minister's statement.